Yeah, man, like you said, there's like a ton of talented people here in Vegas. I think like I read somewhere that Vegas has the most entertainers per capita.
I wouldn't be surprised.
I mean, because it's just, you know, like not such a big population as it is over in LA or New York, but like most of the, like, you know, a lot of us are, you know, somehow connected in the entertainment field,
Well, plus, I'm finding that a lot of us are not originally from Vegas. So, I mean, you get people from all over the world, which is really kind of interesting as well.
Right.
You know what I mean? A nice diversity
Yeah, absolutely. It's
situation happening.
like I've had the opportunity to I start off with, well, shoot, I don't know, maybe I should save this.
No, you go right ahead.
Okay,
That's the whole idea.
because
This
okay,
is just a
like
candid sort of talk about, you know.
because like I you know, everybody remembers me as like the Chippendale. But, you know, I started off in musical theater. I started off taking ballet and singing lessons and jazz and tap and hip hop and music theory. So, you know, not a lot of people realize that. I mean, you know, a lot of people know me from being in the Chippendales, and a lot of people know me. I did like a stripper role in this one low budget movie with Zach Levi, and I played a stripper, and I did a strip contest against Zach Levi. And Kenan Thompson's in it. So that's like kind of the big thing on my IMDb page, anyways. But yeah, like everybody knows me as a stripper, but like I actually, you know, took lessons and had formal training. So,
Well, that's apparent because, I mean, the thing is that, you know, when you do see some of the other work that you've done, you know, I mean, you can sort of see, it's easy to get pigeonholed into the, you know, the one thing or whatever, like you were saying, and sort of gloss over the other things, like the commercial work that you've done. You have done some smaller acting roles, you know, that, you know, are actually pretty good. So, you know,
Thank you.
why not draw more attention to that? And that's hopefully what we're gonna do today as
I
well. Just
appreciate that, man. Thank you. 'Cause like, you know, I got my degree a couple of years ago, and it's, you know, I'm Asian, so I got a degree in computers, and I was going to use my degree and stop performing and hang up my shoes and just my performing shoes and just, you know, be at a desk and just, you know, write code or, you know, design things on the computer. And then, you know, my wife at the time, Fulvia, talked me into continuing performing, and I was like, wow, I'm getting older, you know. I always thought you perform for a while, and then if you haven't reached a certain point within a certain amount of time, then you hang it up and then you do something more secure. And she convinced me to continue performing, and I made a little tweaks to myself, and I've been able to. I stopped playing video games. I played World of Warcraft religiously for like 5 years. I was part of a hardcore raid group.
Really?
Yeah,
Oh my God.
you know, it's sort of an Asian thing. Like I would take time off from work to go and, you know, whenever new expansions came out,
Right,
and
right.
play video games. You
Wow.
know, so
The things we didn't know about Paul
yeah, man. I
Gunn.
guess.
That's great. So thank you to your wife for that, you know, for sure. You
Yeah,
know,
totally, man.
so you when you say you've tweaked things, obviously it sounds like, you know, maybe you changed the way that you approached your acting. Now, did that include you know, maybe formal training, more formal training classes and things like that, or?
You know, I used to live in LA for a little while. It was weird. Like I was working on cruise ships at the time. I was in my mid-20s, and I was singing and dancing for Princess Cruise Lines. And I met this girl on the ship, and she lived in Orange County. And we stayed in touch after she, you know, got off. She was a passenger. And then, like, I got off and went to go. I got my car in Dallas. You know, I was living with my parents at the time. I drove all the way from Dallas to LA to go and visit her. And we weren't really quite getting along. And I wasn't ready to go home yet. So what I did was there was some auditions that I wanted to go to. And so I did the actor thing and stayed in my car, parked on Venice Beach. And I went to a couple of different auditions like the very first week. And I got hired at Disneyland, and I got hired doing a Evita. So,
Wow.
you know, like, I think like what a lot of people say as far as what I've learned is that, you know, in LA, you can make it and you can do well, so long as you had the training. Mm-hmm. So, like, a lot of people go there, I think, with the idea of, okay, my looks are going to get me in.
Right.
Your looks will get you a foot in the door. But if you don't have, like, formal training and practice, and it's not, like, a formal sort of setting or where you've done it repetitiously, then it's harder to make it in.
You have to understand the craft. What it is you're doing. Yeah, it is a job, right, after all. Right. You know what I mean? So,
because there's like, stuff that people will do to prepare and stuff, and then others are like, oh, well, do I really need to do that? And it's like, well, you know, if you don't, there's, like, 10 other people that will.
Right, right.
You know, a lot of it is, like, that I find anyways, is that, you know, it's decisions that people won't make.
Right.
That get you moving into, you know, should I stay in bed and sleep in today, or should I get up and go and train and practice, or, you know, attend this class, or attend this workshop, or go and meet so-and-so, or, you know.
Right.
If you don't do it, there's other people that will.
Yeah. And it is doing the work that ultimately, you know, it does pay off, not to sound cliche, but, you know, anybody that you talk to, you know, in this field, they will all say the same thing. You know, they've usually been around for a long time. Mm-hmm. And it usually takes quite a long time before they kind of get their quote-unquote first break. But I think that whole idea of the first break is kind of a myth that a lot of people don't understand, is that there's no such thing as the first break. It's that you've been working at it for the last 10 years already. And, you know, you've done a lot of different things, and some of them are, you know, it's hit or miss, and but you learn as you go, and you're constantly tweaking, right, what you do.
Yeah,
so,
absolutely.
Yeah, and that seems to be happening for you. I mean, I know, like you were saying, your wife kind of talked you into staying into it, which I'm glad that she did, because you're for the rest of us, we can see that there is that sort of evolution of where we can almost see where you're going to go, you know what I mean, as an actor that's maturing and getting older and getting into some more interesting projects, you know. Even if they're smaller ones, like, you know, we've all caught you in TV commercials and all that, and which is kind of happening more often. But we're starting to see you in films as well. Like, I was at, you know, NAB last year, and I was at the Canon exposition there. And, you know, seeing you in, you know, that production, the Canon film, the short film that they made, you know, with Colin Ward. You know, and those are things that are always kind of a pleasant surprise, and you're like, oh, well, you know, that's good to see that's happening for those people that are doing the work, you know.
Absolutely, yeah. It's any time you get a chance, like, I don't know, like, did you see Jerry Maguire?
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
yeah,
you know, like, the whole part about, you know, not being a paycheck player.
Right.
Okay, that's kind of how I try to treat things, you know, because, like, a lot of people are like, well, do I get a speaking part? Do I get this? Do I get that? Do I get my own trailer? Do I... You know, and I just concentrate more on just focusing on doing the things that I enjoy doing, and then doing it to the best of my abilities, and then that usually translates to a good performance, and then I end up getting calls for other things. I don't. It's like sort of a Buddhist thing. Like, if you're worried about the end result, then you're not in the present moment.
Exactly.
Your mind is somewhere else. You're not concentrated and focused on what's going on.
Right.
Whereas, it, you know, and that usually you end up tripping or dropping something, or, you know, that tends to, because you're not there, present, and aware.
Right.
So that usually leads to something screwing up. Whereas, you know, nowadays I treat things like, you know, what am I doing right here? What is my relationship to the moment?
Mm-hmm.
Am I going with things, or am I fighting with things, you know? And that's how I try to treat things in my life in general, just, you know.
That's a good way to do it. I think that exact notion is something that fits very well with acting, you know, and the craft of acting. You know, it's you saying that reminded me of something that William Hurt said recently about acting, and it really comes down to when you're there having a conversation or whatever it is that's going on, have the conversation that you're having.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? It's like, don't be somewhere else.
Right.
Just, you know, be there and whatever's going on, because that's all there is, really.
Right.
You know,
yeah.
And that's with the listening and all, understanding what's happening and being able to roll with how things are changing as well.
Right. Yeah.
But, I mean, you can't do that if you're worried about something else, or you have some other agenda in mind that you've invented in your head. You
right.
know about.
Yeah.
You know, where is this going to be posted? And
yeah.
Is this going to be on Amazon? And
exactly. Because like, that's the thing. I think, like, because one of my faults anyways was I would just get ahead of myself and I was worried about the outcome of something. Mm-hmm. And, like, for instance, that Fresh and Easy commercial that I did where I was the chef and I had the knife and I spun mm-hmm. around and I chopped the lettuce. I wasn't fixated on how much am I going to make from this. I wasn't fixated on are they going to like me? Am I going to do a good job? Who's going to contact me? Is it, you know, what's going to lead out for? I was concentrating on just hitting that lettuce. You
know? What you did remarkably, I appreciate it. Amazingly cool.
I appreciate it. Like every take, I nailed it. So, yeah. But yeah, and that one particular take that they used, that was the only one that I did where I spun. Yeah. And the rest of them were, you know, a little different. But
you know, it sounds funny because I mean, I'm sure people listen and they go, "Chopping lettuce? What are you talking about?" But it, you know, it is such a Buddha kind of thing to say, like you were talking about, because anybody that's seen that commercial, it's one of those things where you see it on TV and you're like, you're captivated by what's happening because it is such a, I mean, even though it is a commercial, it is a powerful moment. But it's just like you said, you know, you're just focusing on cutting the lettuce and you're doing whatever that particular thing is to the maximum ability that you
right,
can do.
Yeah, right then the lights aren't there, the camera's not right. there, it's just me, a knife, and a lettuce. That's all that's going on in my head right. at the time. So
that's funny. That's kind of like what the epitome of acting should be, you know, as yeah. far as, you know, being in the moment.
Yes, sir.
So, Vegas. Are you originally from Vegas?
I was born in Thailand.
Okay.
And then my parents moved me to Dallas, Texas. Mm-hmm. When I was four. So I grew up in Dallas, and what got me interested in performing, I had this weird, there used to be like a group of neighborhood kids, and we used to get together and play, right? Mm-hmm. And one of the games or like little things that we used to play was we'd get like tennis rackets, and it was back when 80s hair bands were really big,
oh, yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And so we would turn on some music on our little jam box, yeah. and we would pretend like we're playing along with, like, I don't know, it was big back then, like Def Leppard or, mm-hmm. or Quiet oh, Riot yeah. or Poison or something. And I was always the singer. So everybody was playing on like tennis rackets, and yeah. I had a vacuum cleaner that I would use the handle as like a microphone.
Yeah.
And so I was always a singer. And from that point, I was like, I really love doing this. I like pretending yeah. like I'm a singer. So I had this weird notion where I wanted to be a singer. So when I got to high school, there was choir. I joined choir. Mm-hmm. And we happened to have what's called a show choir mm-hmm. at our high school. And the show choir is where you do like basic step touch choreography, mm-hmm. Couple partnering mm-hmm. dance work. And he also taught us tap. There was two high schools where I went to, like in the community that I went to. Like our high school was like the show choir, yeah. and then the other high school was like the stand up on the risers and sing, just, you know, like very strict choral music type okay. stuff. You know, and I was more of the show choir, and so I was into like musicals and musical theater. Mm-hmm. And our teacher taught us how to, you know, dance and do like really simple step touch stuff. Mm-hmm. And we did musicals every year, and just from that point on, I got really interested in dancing because I was like really, really shy of talking to girls, and like the girls always seemed to gravitate towards the guys that knew how to dance. Yeah. And so I went to this local dance studio by my house, and you know, I was like, you know, my teacher said, well, my choir teacher was like, what do you want to do when you grow up? And I said, you know, I want to be a dancer because it looks really fun and all the girls seem to like dancers. And she said, well, he said, well, you should go and take dance lessons. And I was like, okay. And he said, go and see if you can get a dance scholarship or take some dance classes somewhere. Mm-hmm. So there was a local dance studio by my house. I went in, I talked to the owner, and, you know, she probably might have thought that, you know, I would have lost interest in it like after a month or two. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I was like, if you allow me to take class, I'll perform for you in your productions and I'll also compete for you. And she's like, okay, sure. So I took ballet and jazz and tap and hip hop mm-hmm. and that's how I got my formal training. And then I also sung, you know, I sang at school in choir. Mm-hmm. And then like I started doing like, you know, like singing and dancing stuff. And my first professional gig was at Six Flags over mm-hmm. Texas. It was at an amusement park that we had there. So I did the amusement park thing for a while. I got, you know, there was a cruise line that came to town eventually, and I knew I needed to get out of Dallas. Mm-hmm. And so I auditioned for the cruise line, and I ended up getting hired, and I went and traveled around. I met a girl on the ship who was a casino dealer. She's from Hungary, and we ended up getting married, and we moved here. She dealt cards in a casino, and I performed in different shows on the strip. This was like back in 2000. Mm-hmm. So
you've been here for quite a long time.
I've been here for a while. Yeah.
So, but that's good to know, though, because, you know, again, you know, people don't realize that, you know, people like yourself and others have been, you've been at this for a long time, and there's a lot of discipline involved, and there's a lot of, like, maybe not so glamorous times, right, where you're doing a lot of hard work for a long period of time, and you're paying your dues kind of thing, you know what I mean? Before you start seeing you show up in, like, films and all that kind of stuff, they're like, oh, that guy's great, and it's like, well, yeah, he's been around for the last 15 years, and, you know, working at it, you know?
There's like, times, like, because I've been doing, like, gig work and you know, dancing and modeling and stuff, mm-hmm. and the acting stuff was kind of on the side, like, tugging at me mm-hmm. and trying to get my attention, and I saw that the interview that you had with Paul X. Campanella, and he's amazingly knowledgeable and mm-hmm. knows his craft inside and out. I loved watching the interview, and I was thinking to myself, oh my God, you know, I haven't been at acting for a long time. I mean, I've done stuff in the past, but it was because I was the Asian guy mm-hmm. at the talent and modeling
agency.
Yeah, and if they needed an Asian guy, they'd end up calling me. Mm-hmm. So I ended up picking up parts that way. Mm-hmm. And, you know, everybody, you know, there's a couple of things that people always used to say to me as I was growing up. And one of them was, like, you have a really nice speaking voice. And I go, oh, I appreciate it. Thank you very much. And then the other thing was, like, well, did you ever consider being an actor? And I'm like, do you know how many people try to be actors? Right. I mean, how many, like, want to be actors and they're just, you know, waiting tables or, I don't know, doing whatever it is that actors do? And I'm like, I'd never thought of myself as being able to do that for a living, honestly. And I just, when Fulvia talked to me about it, about continuing, I'm like, I'm getting older and I haven't, you know, hit yet. And she's like, well, you need to adjust some things about yourself. You need to take some lessons. You need to get some pictures done, some, like, good pictures. And I was like,
well, the age doesn't really matter, though. That's the thing about the acting is that, you know, it's kind of like, it's like good wine, you know, just like it seasons and matures over time.
That's what I'm recognizing.
So is it a surprise to you to start to understand that everything that you have been doing up until now is actually exactly like a lot of other successful actors?
I guess, because, like, you know, because, okay, with the singing and the dancing, that's great, because then you get a sense of movement and rhythm and coordination, and you can learn to count music, and you understand, like, music theory, so that really helps out a lot. And then, like, when I was working on the ships, I thought of ships as, I ended up, like, recognizing ships as being like the old vaudeville stuff, because you worked with a lot of jugglers and singers and magicians and comedians and you know, just people from the old vaudeville era. And so I did the production shows on the ship, and I sang and I danced in them, and then there were other nights where, you know, other entertainment would take place, and so you had all these different variety acts that would come on the ship and perform, and so you met them, and then you saw how they perform, you get an idea of, like, comedic timing and stuff, and, you know, how that's, and then also I had crew staff duty, which is, like, basically you're the camp counselors on the ship. So whenever the ship was at sea, you had to keep all the passengers occupied with things. So you ended up having to, like, call bingo or host a ping pong tournament or a shuffleboard tournament. So, like, it was really simple stuff. You just basically, you know, make announcements and say, hi, everybody, welcome. My name is Paul, and I'm going to be your shuffleboard tournament leader for today, and we're going to have sign-ups right here, and then everybody, and then you just pair them off, and then you just crown the winner, and then, all right, the next thing that's coming up is at 5:30, we're going to have coffee and company, and then at 6 o'clock is going to be dinner, and then we're going to have a show, and then, so it's like you basically talk about what's going on the ship, and you got a sense of how to talk to a group of people, and so that's how I learned how to do MC work and microphone and hosting work, so... Right. And I just, you know, it's kind of like, you know, did you ever watch The Secret or read the book, The Secret?
The book, yes.
Yeah, okay. So, you know, it's kind of like, for me, it's been like, okay, they said you can get from L.A. to New York driving through the dark with just your headlights on, mm-hmm. and you just see the next 200 feet ahead of you with your right. headlights, and then right. you could just make it all the way from LA to New York in the dark. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of how my life's been. It's just, I didn't know what was going to happen, and then all of a sudden, like at the last second, something would pop up or an opportunity would come, and then you recognize the opportunity, mm-hmm. and you just kind of embrace it. And I have to say that a lot of my opportunities that would come, there was this saying that I remember I heard Ashton Kutcher say. He said, opportunity looks like a lot of hard work. Mm-hmm. It comes disguised as hard work. Mm-hmm. So sometimes you're going to get something, like a friend of yours is going to call you up and they're going to say, hey, look, I have this really great idea. I want to do this and I want to have this happen. And then, you know, and you're thinking to yourself, oh, okay, well, it's going to require right. some work and right. some, you know, time to write it and time to rehearse. And, but then, you know, you can look at it as though, okay, is this going to be worth my time? Or, you know, am I going to enjoy this? Or you could be like, embrace it. Is this something that I enjoy doing? And, you know, they say that you either do things because you make money at it or because you enjoy doing it. And I try to embrace the things that I enjoy doing. And right. then that just generally leads me to whatever happens next, you know?
That's good, though. That's yeah, good. Yeah, yeah. And it definitely teaches you a lot about work ethic, too. You know, having, you know, done things right. in that way, yeah. you know. It's like, I think a lot of people have a sense of sort of instant gratification, especially when it comes to, you know, entertainment arts, you know, yeah, creative definitely. Arts. Where you think it's, you know, because you look a certain way or something like that, that's enough. And they, once you see that there's actually work involved, I think a lot of people go running away.
Right. There's another saying that I remember. I took a workshop in LA, and the guy was like, well, think of, you know, instead of picking the fruit from the tree, just concentrate on watering the tree. Mm-hmm. So that's what you have exactly. to constantly exactly. remember to do, just maintain, and it's an instrument, and you have to constantly use it and
exactly.
keep practicing.
Yeah, exactly. Know? So, that being said, what are some of the current projects that you're working on or involved in or maybe are in development or something like that you could share with us?
Right now, I'm in a film called Bleach with, it's Cat Eat Bird Productions, Lenka Fuchikova and Michael Edmonds are... are producing and Lenka wrote it, mm-hmm. and I'm in that with my buddy Mark Justice, and it's a psychological thriller, and I don't want to give too much away about
yeah,
it.
Yeah, no spoilers. Yeah, no spoilers.
but yeah, Mark does a fantastic job, and he's like plays a kind of a troubled guy and does some very despicable things, and then he's haunted by the memories or ghosts of these people that he did these despicable things to. So,
and what's your role in this?
I play a couple of different characters, but like basically my character is I'm like this devil sort of character, or it's Akon, and he's the basically the you know, like in the Greek mythology, when you pass away and your family puts like the coins on your eyes, he's the ferryman is basically it. And so I play the ferryman, and I show up from time to time in whenever the character, Mark's character, he's, you know, kind of going in and out of reality. And so I will, you know, kind of show up as a farmer there and antagonize
him
cool. and stuff.
That's cool.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
Totally cool.
So there's that. And then next month I will be going with Albert Pune and Cynthia Kernan and Michael Su to Croatia to go and film a sci-fi film. And it's called Interstellar Civil War. And I'm very excited about that. I've been to Croatia before, but it's my first time in Zagreb. And Brad Thornton's in it. He did Kickboxer 2. And he's been a great help to me for, you know, helping me to figure out my character and to, you know, get prepared for the movie. So
that's really great.
Because I don't know, did you ever watch Albert Pyun stuff?
Oh well, I mean he's made stuff from way back when.
Yeah,
so yeah,
yeah.
I mean we're talking as far back as the '80s, really.
Right.
You know
what
I mean? So
You know, I when I was a kid, I remember seeing The Sword and the Sorcerer, and I was just like, I'd always like. It took my breath away, and I was always like, I love that movie. And then you know, fast forward years, and it's just weird how things just kind of lead up to where you are. And I remember being a kid just watching that movie, and Cyborg, too. And then, you know, finding out that Albert Pyun lives here, and he still does stuff, and, you know, he asked me to, you know, participate in his film with him. And
it's funny how that works, huh?
Yeah, man.
Just keep doing the work, keep watering the tree, like you said. And people are going to notice, you know.
Yeah, and that's what and that's been kind of the crux of it, because like it's kind of like when you want to catch your cat.
Yeah.
If you chase after your cat keeps on running away from you. But then if you just calm down and have a seat and relax, then it'll come to you when it's time to. And it's just, you just embrace it at the moment.
Be something the cat wants.
Yeah. You know, just. I think there was a saying that goes, you know, make the noise, you know, work in silence very diligently and very hard and prepare and everything in silence, and then let your success make the noise for you.
Right.
You
know? That's so true. That's a great way to put it, too, because, I mean, you see a lot of the opposite today. I mean, just so much of the opposite. There's so much noise.
Yeah.
And I think that's what, you know, things like social media and Facebook and all these things, I think that's what it brings us, is a method to create a lot of noise, and a lot of people, they stop there. They stop there, and they just see it as a loud whistle, and they just keep blowing it and just, making noise. And, you know, it's just, it's interesting to see you put it that way, because what you're saying is still the way that works. You know what I mean? You know, and even, you still have to do the work.
Yeah, absolutely. Because that's a whole thing. Like, because it's not what you do once in a while. It's what you do consistently over a long period of time.
Exactly. Yeah.
And, you know, I wish I could say that there was an easy way to make it. But, like, you have to pay your dues. You have to study. You have to practice. I mean, like, okay, there's a certain way I look. I wish I could say there was a certain pill that you can take or a certain exercise you can do, but it's diet. It's like, you know, it's all the stuff that people don't want to do.
Right.
You know, and
it's all hard work.
It's whatever energy that you, because whatever you choose to not do, that's fine, but somebody else will choose to do it. So that's what I try to keep in mind with doing things. You know?
Well, that's really great. I mean, thanks for sharing that part with us. What I did want to ask you, a couple other things actually, was now that you've been in Vegas for a long time, and you've been working in Vegas as an actor and as a model and doing commercials and films and all that, and you've gotten a sense of what Las Vegas is like as far as the local community of creative people, actors and filmmakers. What is something that you would like to say to the local community as far as what would you like to see happen in the local community as far as maybe things that you would like to see change or things that you would like to maybe illuminate on that, you know, people should pay attention to in a good way? Or, you know, just, I think you kind of get what I'm saying, right?
Yeah, you know, something that I would like to see is that just people be more helpful to each other a little more and be more active in what's going on as far as the performing community and you know, like there's the 48-hour project and you know, film project, and you know, just, I don't know, it's like, okay, one of the things that I learned from playing World of Warcraft is that there's only, and it's just the same thing with life, there's only a certain distance that you can go when you're by yourself, and then from that point on, if you want to do the bigger and better things, that's when you have to team up with other people. Because you need, like, you know, you need your healers, and you need your fireball mage throwers, and you need your sword fighters, and okay, so it's like a group sort of thing, and so, like, and I think that's the same thing with life, and that's the same thing that I would like to see here, is that, you know, you put it out there, and that you're supportive of other people, and that you go and help, and contribute in some way, and then, you know, like, maybe, like it become like more of a big think tank sort of thing, and
more of a cooperative.
Yeah, that's what I would like to see. Anyways, I think a lot of people are, you know, because we're always, you know, in competition with each other, and everybody's trying to outdo each other and whatever. Right. And I just, like I said, when I go into auditions, I don't go in the idea of I need this job, I need to get this, I need to book this, I go in there with the idea of just having fun. Like, you know, let's see how we can create today. Let's see how we can make this part take shape and form, and you know, what can I do to bring, you know, a different sort of light to this character or to this story, or you know, let's be creative, because I might not get the part, but then when they see that, you know, you're fun, easygoing, and you're creative, and you know, basically a good person to work with, then they'll think of you for something that is right for you.
Right.
So, and then that's the whole thing that I have, you know, as far as my philosophy with, you know, I'm not worried about the outcome of the audition. I'm worried about just having a good time. Yeah. And then just letting it go, and then, you know, saying thank you for having me, and I leave.
Yeah. That's a great work ethic,
yeah,
to have.
I philosophy. Thank you.
So what's next for Paul Gunn? What's after this film that you're working on now, or these couple film projects, what's your goal after that?
After we should be in Zagreb till the beginning of April, and then we might have to do some ADR work on the movie, and then I was just gonna plan to pack up and move to LA in May. I'm with the Prestige agency out there, and I also have a couple of friends that are manager friends of mine, so. Wanted to go out there and pursue acting full time, film work and commercials and whatnot. So, but I'll be coming back and forth.
Yeah, a lot of people do. They're constantly going back and forth.
Yeah.
So that's good. I mean, it's exciting. I mean, I know that we've all seen some cool things happen in your life in the last couple of years. You know, if we're just sort of like paying attention out there, so it's kind of exciting to see where you'll be in another year or two.
Thank you.
It'll be fun to watch for sure. All right, well, thank you, Mr. Gunn, for coming down and
talking
to us.
Thanks for having me. Goodbye, everybody.